Welcome to our next lecture in the series on condensed matter theory. In this video, I want to have a look at the eigenstates of the spin orbit coupling operator for single electrons and the spin orbital wave functions that emerge from that, and have a look at their spatial or basically angular dependent structure that we have. I will refer for most of the formulas and their derivations to previous videos, and in this video we'll basically have a look at nice pictures that show these states. What we've seen in the previous video is that we can write down our tight binding Hamiltonian with spin orbit coupling as a tight binding Hamiltonian for spin up and tight binding Hamiltonian for spin down, which are equal to each other except that one acts on the spin up states, one on the spin down states. So for a p-shell, we have the px, py, pz orbital. It gives you a tight binding Hamiltonian, and now you just double this, one for spin up and spin down. And then on top of that, you have the spin orbit coupling that acts locally. So we can have a look at that local operator interacting between the angular momenta LZ SZ plus an L plus L minus operator, or we can go to the real spherical harmonics, the cubic harmonics, and have the interaction that is easier for your tight binding Hamiltonian, which is just a unitary basis transformation between them. So what I want to do in this video is have a look at the eigenstates of this matrix that you see here for the S, P, D and F shell, when I only show it of course here for the P shell, for a single site. And we have seen before what the size of the coupling constant is, somewhere between 10 mEV and 1 electron volt going through the periodic table. So we'll not focus on zeta and the radial wave functions, but on the L dot S for a single electron, and have a look what the spin orbitals are that we work on. And we can write down our interaction as an Lx, Sx, Ly, Sy, Lz, Sy, or as an Ls, Lz, Sz plus a half L plus S minus L minus S plus. And it's of course the later form that easily allows you to calculate matrix elements. We've also seen that the total angular momentum, L plus S, commutes with H, not L or S separately. So it is the total angular momentum eigenstates that we are interested in, and we can then use Clebsch-Gordan coefficients to do a coupling between states with angular momentum L and states with S is a half, such that you get the LZ plus or minus S at a half linear combinations with spin up and spin down to give you your LSJJZ spin orbitals. And it is those wave functions that I want to have a look at. Now, when you want to make plots of those, you have to realize that now each point in space is assigned a vector in a complex Hilbert space projecting on the basis state with spin down and spin up. One way to represent this is to make a plot where you say the radial distance that I plot my wave function is equal to the spherical harmonics complex conjugated times the spherical harmonics. And that is what you do when you have normal spin orbitals or normal orbitals without spin orbit coupling, for example. And then you have still the surface that you can use to color your wave function, and here I use that to color it according to the phase. So we see here an S orbital, then the P orbital with angular momentum minus 101, the D orbital, angular momentum minus 2, minus 1012, and the F orbital. If you look at the phase, then the P orbital, the phase rotates once around, the D orbital rotates twice around, in the F orbital you rotate three times around in phase when you change around the Z direction. And that you see of course very nicely when you look at the top view. Here the phase rotates once around the Z direction, here the phase rotates twice around the Z direction, and here the phase three times. And of course that depends what the value of M is, minus 101, minus 2, minus 1012, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, etc. Now we have to plot a vector, So how can we do this? Well, we can still plot this charge density contour, and then we can use the color, for example, to represent the different parts of your Hilbert space. If it's spin down, we make it red. If it's spin up, we make it blue. So one has to be a bit careful, because this complex Hilbert space is a construct that we made. Any unitary transformation of these two basis states would also be a valid basis. So instead of saying spin up and spin down in the z direction, we could have also quantized in the x or the y direction. So the color that you now put on top of this surface is related to your basis choice. So that is a construct that we make. So if we look at your atomic orbitals without spin orbit coupling, then we say we have states with spin up, which are spin down, which are perfectly red, and states with spin up, which are perfectly blue. So you lose the information on the phase, but for that you now have information on what the spin is. Now if you look at the atomic spin orbitals on a JJZ basis, then for the S orbital we have angular momentum zero. So the coupling there is very simple. You just have the spin up and spin down states, and those are the eigenstates of your S orbital, either perfectly completely red or completely blue. So the J is a half originating from the L orbital, or from the S orbital, are just given by spin down and spin up. If you look at the P orbitals, then we can make an angular momentum of 1 minus a half, so total J is a half, or 1 plus a half makes it 3 half. These are now linear combinations of PZ with, or P0 with spin down, and P minus 1 with spin up for the P a half state. And you see that indeed you now get different parts of the wave function that have either a spin up or a spin down part. There is an entanglement between spin up and spin down. You also see that there are bands where the projection of the spin on the z direction is zero. This is the case when you have equal amount of spin up and spin down electrons in that basis set. That doesn't mean that you do not have spin polarization at that point in space. If you would quantize in a different basis, up plus down gives spin in the x direction, up plus I down would give you spin in the y direction. So you might still, or you actually do find some spin polarization in here. It's just that on this basis projection you don't see it. It also means that if you would look at such a p orbital in a magnetic field, depending on the direction where you look, you would either see an electron with spin down or an electron with spin up. You can measure this, for example, with elastic neutron scattering, where this is known as the atomic form factor. And you can write these as linear combinations of the spin up and spin down orbitals. And then you also see that this comes back into the colors that we have. Now, instead of the p orbitals, you can also look at the d orbitals, where we have angular momentum 2, such that the total momentum is either 3 half or 5 half. And also here you see that you have these alternatings between spin up and spin down density, because of the, well, the nodes that you have between a d0 and a d1 sitting in different positions. And you make linear combinations between them with spin up and spin down in order to get these different orbitals. And also here you can just look at the prefactors, which are just your Clebsch-Gordan coefficients that we have. If we look at an example, for example, the state with J is 3 half and JZ is minus 1 half, the blue one here, then this is a linear combination of the LZ is 0 with spin down and the LZ is minus 1 with spin up, such that JZ is minus 1 half in both cases. And you see that in the XY plane, the LZ is minus 1 has a node, whereas the LZ is 0 not, so you have some red. In the Z direction, also there, the LZ is minus 1 has a node, the LZ is 0 not, so your total density has spinned down, whereas in between there is some angle where the LZ is zero, has a node, whereas the LZ is minus one knot, and there your spin turns into up. So you have, depending on the direction where you look, a spin down, a spin up, and a spin down polarization of your local electrons. So there is a clear coupling between the spin direction that you have and the angular momenta that we have in our wave functions. So there is a clear coupling between the JZ and the spin polarization that you have as a function of distance or a function of direction in your atomic orbitals. Now this of course will come back when you make tight binding Hamiltonians of this, and the spin is also rotating in here, but that will become even more of a better shown when we make vector field plots of these orbitals. And then of course you have these prefectors given by the Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. And similar again for the F orbitals, where you have these linear combinations of spin up and spin down, and therefore depending on the direction where you look, you either see spin up or spin down electrons in that orbital. And also here the prefectors are just your Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. So that's one way how to look at these wave functions. Now, spin is given by two states, either spin up or spin down. But if we quantize in the x, y, or z direction, or any other unitary transformation of these two states, is completely up to your own preference. There is no need to quantize in the z direction. So anything that depends on this choice of two basis functions cannot have a physical meaning. And that's a problem with these plots that we had before in terms of color. There is some meaning in there because, well, you have this rotation of states between different basis states, and when you have that one particular wave function, then that definitely means something. But you should be allowed to, instead of quantizing the z direction, quantize in the x or the y direction, and you would get different patches of color on these different wave functions. Now, there is actually a way to look at observables instead of your basis states. And that we can do by looking at a vector field. We can calculate the local spin polarization. If you take your wave function, complex conjugated, times the spin operator, times the wave function, then the spin operator has three components, Sx, Sy, and Sz. So wave function, spin operator, wave function gives you a vector, each point of space. So each point of space is now assigned a vector, which gives you the local magnetization, or the local spin magnetization that you have due to that one electron. This vector field is an observable. If you do inelastic neutron scattering, you scatter on the local spin projection, or elastic neutron scattering, you scatter on the local spin projection, and what you would measure is the Fourier transform of exactly this object. So you can take a single atom, put it in a magnetic field, scatter with neutrons off of that, do it many often because the interaction is very small, then measure the angular distribution, Fourier transform, and this is the vector field that you obtain. There's a phase missing. If you make an hologram, have your neutron beam interfere with the straight beam, you should be able to do that Fourier transform actually without additional information needed. It's going to be a hell of an experiment because the interaction is so small. But in a solid where you have these atoms on the regular lattice, this is known as the atomic form factor. So it's very well known that you have this kind of internal structures and atomic form factors in your materials. Now, the local vector field cannot be taken completely arbitrary. We have only two basis states and we now have a three-dimensional vector. this one additional degree of freedom that you have because you have a third component in your vector actually is restrained because the length of your vector is always a half h bar times the local density. Spin is always completely polarized of a single electron. That spin is always pointing somewhere in space, and the length of your spin projection is just a half h bar times the local density that you have. So now we can make plots of these electron spin densities. And if we look at an s orbital, then you either have the s orbital with spin down. Here the z projection is given in blue, and we here have an arrow that is pointing in the down direction, or you have an s electron with spin up. And here the s orbital is pointing in the up direction for all states. Instead of having a look at the s electron, you can look at the p orbital with j a half. And now you have your spin polarization rotating in the up direction via the y direction to down, rotating again back to up, either for up, down, up in the j minus one half, or down, up, down for the j one half state. When the spin is in the y direction, I made it green. When it is in the z direction, I made it red. And that's what you then see. So it's nicely rotating around here, making these kind of double loops when you rotate in all directions. So there is an entanglement between the projection where the spin is pointing and the direction in which you look. So if you would be able to look at a certain angle at these orbitals, you would find a perfectly spin polarized spin. And the direction of that spin polarization depends on the direction in which you look at this atomic orbital. And the same is true when you go to the JS3 half states. The state where JZ is J is again fully spin polarized, whereas the JS1 half states, now the spin rotates depending on the direction where you look in space. And you can make similar plots for the d orbitals, in this case for the JS3 half or the JS5 half, which would be six different states that we have. So this entanglement between local direction where you look and the spin that we have becomes really important when you look at magnetic inisotropies, for example, where now this couples the spin direction to the crystallographic directions, and therefore gives you preferences in which your magnetic moments want to lie, which when you make, for example, hard magnets, becomes very important in applications. You also see that the spin here starts to rotate in certain patterns, giving you winding numbers in how often you rotate around the nucleus. These cannot be continuously transformed into each other, therefore giving you different topologies between these different spin directions. And that becomes important when we talk about topological states in topological insulators or magnetic topological materials. Where spin-orbit coupling immediately gives you an entanglement or between these kind of rotations of spin direction and crystallographic directions that we have in our materials. And this then comes back in, for example, Fermi surfaces or in K-space, where these directions are then can be inherited if you have the correct materials. For now, thank you very much for your attention. I hope to have shown you a little bit what the relativistic effects are and do to the eigenstates that we have in atoms. We will go into several different examples later in this lecture, where this then also has applications for real materials. For now, thank you very much. Stay healthy. We see each other later.